Good morning. Go ahead and grab your Bible and join me in Genesis chapter 6. And if you need a Bible, there's one there in the pew in front of you. And so good to see you here today. You are the faithful few. You've lost an hour. Many of your friends and even family maybe are in warmer climates at the beach. I mean, even our faithful worship pastor, Pastor Steve, has abandoned us on this day. But you are the remnant, my friends. Welcome. And way to stick it out with the rest of us. And let's be honest, it's cold and windy at the beach too. So we can take satisfaction in knowing they're all the way down there, but they're still disappointed. And that makes us feel better about ourselves stuck here in Jackson, Tennessee. But they're not here today. And so we're excited to be here. And I do thank the guys leading us in worship this morning. And excited about God's word this morning as we open it together. And before we get there, let me remind you, Easter's coming. It feels like it's coming early this year because it's in March. But on March 31st, just a couple of weeks away, it's Easter Sunday. And it's always obviously a great day of celebration for the church, but it's also an opportunity for you to invite somebody to join you on that day. And people are much more likely to come and visit a church on Easter Sunday than the other day. Take them to lunch, pick them up, meet them in the commons area out there. But it's just, once again, we would encourage you to begin now praying and thinking about someone you can invite to be with us here on Easter Sunday. And also, you may have read this in the midweek, but we need you to come thinking, hey, I'm coming to serve, right? Because we are. We're going to have people on our campus who are not typically here. And so for those of you guys who are here on, a Sunday during spring break, you are the ones. We need you to come with the attitude of being welcoming, and you do that so well anyway, but just coming and thinking about serving. And one of the areas that we need people to serve still is our preschool worship care. They meet during this hour. In fact, right now they're having worship, and they're singing and doing motions. They're reading a Bible story, and so it's a whole other little worship service going on, actually just down the hall over here. And if you could help on Easter Sunday, that would be huge. And just let Ruth Myers, our preschool director, know if you need some help finding her. Connect with one of our pastors or go by the Connection Center out here. And if you serve on that day, maybe you want to serve as your family. You want to, hey, say, our family is going to choose to serve on that day. Then we are having a worship service that morning at 7 a.m. We've not done that before, but we're going to have a worship service at 7 a.m. It's going to be a little different than this one. It'll be in Generations Hall, and obviously we won't have as much of the setup that we have in here. But we are going to worship together at 7, and we're going to provide you breakfast because we don't want you to feel like you have to go home, or, you know, we want you to stick around and serve in your community group or go to your community groups. And so that morning, Easter morning at 7 a.m., it's not an Easter sunrise service because we don't really know what the weather is going to bring. And so we're going to just play it safe. And you can drive here on the sunrise and catch it on the way here, but we're going to actually worship in the building. But that'll be an early worship time, and you're welcome to join us then. So, and we hope you'll consider doing that. Well, this morning we're going to look at the story of Noah's Ark. And I think Noah's Ark is one of the most misunderstood, really, Bible stories that we have. And we have to remember it's in the grander picture of the story, right? The Bible is a story of God's redemption of mankind, and Noah's Ark somehow fits in there. But it really is. It's unique in the fact that if you stand back and just read it, out from an outsider's perspective, Noah's Ark is really one of the most horrifying stories in the Bible. But we've made it, and I understand why, more of a children's story. In fact, I remember one of the first kids' musicals I was a part of was Noah's Ark. And I don't know if I was in kindergarten or first grade, but I remember there was, they built this big ark up on the church platform, and all the kids were leading in it. And I was actually, they had the young kids dress up as animals. And I remember, I'm still bitter. I remember some kids got to be like lions and bears and tigers. I was a rabbit. Like me and this other girl, we were paired up with someone else, and we walked in as white bunny rabbits. I don't know that there were white bunny rabbits on the ark, but anyway, so that, we've made it into a children's story, and maybe you've even seen, and it's just odd because I've never seen a children's story about Sodom and Gomorrah, right? No, nobody's acting that one out, but the ark is much more horrifying than Sodom and Gomorrah. You don't see babies' rooms themed, right? D-Day. You know what I mean? It's just not something that's something we tend to do, but it just goes to show you how far we've gone and separate ourselves from the reality of what we see here in Genesis chapter 6 through 9. On the other hand, some people look at the story and see it for what it is, and they're a little shocked that God would do this, that God would wipe out all his creation, wipe out mankind. They're offended by God. And in a way, they step back and they put God in the courtroom, and they stand in judgment of God. Other people have gone to another extreme. They don't even believe the story actually took place. In fact, we know there are other ancient stories about floods, the Epic of Gilgamesh. You may have read that in high school English or college English, and other ancient literature have stories of floods like this. And some people look at this story and say, well, it's just legendary, right? It's just a fairy tale in a way. But the truth is, the evidence of all, the fact that there are these other stories about floods are really evidence that there actually was a flood. If there actually was a world flood, right, that wiped out all of mankind, then from that you would have different stories that actually come about. But the story of Noah and his ark is unique, and we believe that through the providence of God, Moses actually recorded the story as it actually happened. And so how should we think of the story about Noah's ark? Well, ultimately, I think it's a picture of how God uses judgment to bring about restoration. I think it's a picture of how God uses judgment to restore things. Not just destroy things, but ultimately to restore things. And so let's read. We're actually going to read the entirety of chapter 6, so stay with me here. But it gives a good beginning to the story, and I'm going to just assume that most of you already know parts of the story. We're not going to be able to have time to share it all in detail. But in Genesis chapter 6, verse 1, it says this: When mankind began to multiply on the earth and daughters were born to them, the sons of God saw that the daughters of mankind were beautiful. And they took any as they chose as wives for themselves. And the Lord said, My spirit will not remain with mankind forever because they are corrupt. Their days will be 120 years. The Nephilim were on the earth both in those days and afterward, and when the sons of God came to the daughters of mankind who bore children to them, they were the powerful men of old, the famous men. And when the Lord saw that human wickedness was widespread on the earth and that every inclination of the human mind was nothing but evil all the time, the Lord regretted that he had made man on the earth, and he was deeply grieved. And then the Lord said, I will wipe mankind whom I created off the face of the earth, together with the animals, creatures that crawl, and the birds of the sky, for I regret that I made them. Noah, however, found favor with the Lord. And these are the family records of Noah. Noah was a righteous man, blameless among his contemporaries. Noah walked with God. And Noah fathered three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. And now the earth was corrupt in God's sight, and the earth was filled with wickedness. God saw how corrupt the earth was, for every creature had corrupted its way on the earth. And then God said to Noah, I have decided to put an end to every creature, for the earth is filled with wickedness because of them. Therefore, I am going to destroy them along with the earth. Make yourself an ark of gopher wood, make rooms in the ark, and cover it with pitch inside and outside. And this is how you are to make it. The ark will be 450 feet long, 75 feet wide, and 45 feet high. You are to make a roof, finishing the sides of the ark within 18 inches of the roof. And you are to put a door in the side of the ark. Make it with lower, middle, and upper decks. Understand that I am bringing a flood waters on the earth to destroy every creature under heaven with the breath of life in it. Everything on earth will perish, but I will establish my covenant with you, and you will enter the ark with your son's wife and your son's wives. And you are also to bring into the ark two of all the living creatures, male and female, to keep them alive with you. Two of everything, from the birds according to their kinds, from the livestock according to their kinds, and from the animals that crawl on the ground according to their kinds, will come to you so that you can keep them alive. Take with you every kind of food that is eaten. Gather it as food for you and for them. And Noah did this, and he did everything that God had commanded him. Let's pray together. Father, as we come to your word this morning, we admit, Lord, that it's hard for us to understand at times, that we tend to step back and see life through our own eyes, Lord, and through our own eyes only. And so this morning, we ask you to reveal to us the truth of your word. Lord, help us to see this event in the light of history, Lord, and through your eyes, for our good and for your glory. And we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Well, I've discovered over studying these three chapters the past week and even over the past several weeks that you could spend a lot of time diving into the story of Noah, and we're going to cover it in just 1 week. And so what I want to do this morning is I want to stay on the main roads. There's lots of little roads you could get off to, just kind of you're driving down the interstate. There's two ways to take a trip. If you're trying to get to a destination, you can stay on the interstate or the main highways and make it to your destination, or you can spend a day, right, hitting off little exits and visiting little towns and finding little restaurants. Well, we don't have necessarily time to do all that, but it's there. It's there. And so this morning, we're going to stay on the main roads. And here are some of the main roads I'm going to go ahead and give you here at the beginning that we're going to stay on. Now, we are going to cover a few areas that are maybe a little bit more difficult to understand. And so if you're familiar with the story, I'm going to give you some thoughts on some of the more complicated issues that are dealt with here, especially in chapter 6. But here are the main roads that we're going to stay on. They are this. Number one, we're going to see the sinfulness of man, the judgment of God, the salvation of God, and the restoration of God. The sinfulness of man, the judgment of God, the salvation of God, and the restoration of God. Notice first, we see the sinfulness of man. As the Lord looked down on his creation in Genesis chapter 1, he sees it and he pronounces it good. But here in Genesis chapter 6, the Lord once again is looking over his creation, and it has become utterly corrupted by man. It's no longer good. And they're no longer only committing acts of evil, they are reveling in them. That's all that he sees. Humankind that's wicked and being destroyed by sin. And there's a couple of specific ways that we see this here in Genesis chapter 6. First of all, we see sexual perversion. One of the ways that society was corrupt during these days was sexual perversion. And we see that, I think, here in the first few verses as he talks about these sons of God in verses 2 and 3. And this is one of those, once again, if you're familiar with Scripture, one of those questions that people have debated over for centuries. Who are the sons of God that were taking these, that found the daughters of men beautiful and were taking any as they wish for their wives? And there's a few different options here that scholars have come up with. Number one, one option is that they see these sons of God as a dynasty of kings. In other places in Scripture, you see rulers and judges and magistrates. Sometimes they're referred to as sons of God. Even sometimes they even appear as gods. But I would say here, we're not going to spend much time there because I think that's kind of out of place. We don't even see mentions of kings and magistrates here prior to Genesis chapter 6. And so I don't necessarily think that's the best explanation of what the Scripture is teaching here. Another option, and this is probably there are two main options that people go with, and I would say both are acceptable, both are legitimate. In fact, even in some of the resources that I was looking at, they were evenly divided between these last two options. One option is this, is these sons of God are the angels, some kind of supernatural beings. And we see this in Scripture often, especially in the book of Job, the first chapter of Job, second chapter of Job, we see that the Bible speaks as the sons of God, as angels that come before the Lord. And we also know that in Scripture that we see angels come in human form, and they can even be confused as human beings. We see that in the life of Abraham, don't we, when his three visitors. And so many of the earliest interpreters of the book of Genesis, many of the our forefathers, they considered these sons of God angels. These are references to angels who have somehow come down and married human women and had relationships with human women. And Even people draw connections to the New Testament. I think, once again, I think some of these are legitimate. In 2 Peter and Jude, it refers to angels that have kind of gone beyond the boundaries, who've stepped out of place. And so there are reasons to believe, I think, that these sons of God could be angels. And that these angels look like normal people, right? And they've taken on these, they've taken women as their wives. Now, where I find it a little odd is you don't ever see where angels can procreate or have any kind of sexual relationships with women. And so to me, I don't necessarily, even though I think this is a valid point, I don't necessarily fall in line with this interpretation. And if you do, that's fine. To me, it's just a little bit of a stretch. But once again, I think there's good reasons in the Bible to believe that's exactly who this is. And one of the reasons I think it's a little bit of a stretch, because they're even in the punishment, right, of the flood, it's not the angels that are being punished, it's just mankind. It doesn't seem to be, you know, obviously we know the angels that have fallen and ultimately are bound, but it seems to be the flood is more about punishing humankind. Another way to interpret it, which is ultimately where I fall, would be to see these sons of God as the line of Seth. If you read in chapter 4, we talked about this last week, there's the line of Cain, there's the line of Seth from Adam, and the line of Cain represented, you know, the world, the fallen seed of man, really the imaging, the serpent, and contrary to the ways of God. And then you have the line of Seth, who in Seth's lines introduced by now, right, men start calling on the name of God. Enoch was one who represented the line of Seth as the seventh descendant of Adam on Seth's line, and he was a man who walked with God. And so through the line of Seth, you seem to think that there's this line of people that are following God, seeking the Lord. These are the children of God, the sons of God. And so I think what we have here is we have the line of Seth, God's chosen line, and they were looking out and they were being driven by their lust. They were taking any wives as they chose. They're not just marrying those women that are from their own line, right? Godly women. They're also, and who would share the same faith. I think they're looking out and they're taking, once again, they're driven by their lustful hearts and they're intermarrying with the Cainites and they're picking whichever one they want. And not only that, not just one, but perhaps even more than one. And we know as you read through the Old Testament, this is prohibited by God for his people, because what would happen is they would, when they moved back to the promised land, they would start marrying women of other faiths. And it wasn't more about their ethnicity as it was about their faith. They were marrying women of other faith, and it ultimately ended up being the demise in many ways of God's people as they began to fall after, right, chase after the idols of these foreign people, pagan people. So here I believe we have the line of Seth being driven by their passions, marrying the line of Cain. We have sexual perversion. It's rampant, and we know the destruction it brings to God's people later on in the promised land, and that's exactly what we have happening here in Genesis chapter 6. Not only do we have sexual perversion here and the evil there, we also have violence. In Genesis chapter 4 and 5, we see incredible violence of mankind. We see Cain taking the life of his brother. We see one of Cain's line, this man named Lamech, bragging about taking the life of a young man. And then here in verse 11 and 12, we see the wickedness of man. It can also be translated violence. And I think at the forefront of this violence that's going on between men, mankind, we have the Nephilim, who Moses here refers to in chapter 6. It says, the Nephilim were on the earth both in those days and afterward when the sons of God came to the daughters of mankind who bore children to them. They were the powerful men of old, the famous men. The title Nephilim ultimately means fallen ones. And some people have sought to believe that the Nephilim are actually the offspring of the angels and, right, these fallen angels and the women, right, coming together. Now, once again, I don't take that view. I think when it's referring to the Nephilim, him, they're not talking about offspring of the angels and the women. He's just basically saying this is when this took place. The line of Seth and the line of Cain, right? The line of Seth took the daughters of the line of Cain, whichever they wanted, during the time of the Nephilim. The Nephilim are their contemporaries. And you see this term here, Nephilim, again, in Numbers chapter 13, as the as the Hebrew people were, the Israelite people were seeking to enter into the promised land, and the spies come back, remember, they're scouting the land, and they say, look, we can't take this land. These people are giants. We're like grasshoppers to them, and refers to the people as Nephilim. And so I think, once again, I think probably more than likely, they're being speaking figuratively there. They're saying these people remind us of the Nephilim. They're these giants, right? These large, evil, wicked, violent people back in the days of Noah. And so the Nephilim were evil men who held great power. They were known for their violence. They were intimidating. And so, once again, you can feel free to disagree with me there. But that's what I'm going to go with, and I got the mic, so we can talk more later if you'd like. But ultimately, the Lord looks down, and he sees great violence. He sees sexual perversion. He sees wickedness. Mankind is corrupt. And mankind has corrupted everything that he has created. And at this point, as the Lord looks down and sees what's going on, there's no hope of mankind turning things around, because every inclination, did you notice what he said? Every inclination of the human mind was nothing but evil. All as the Lord looks down, there's no hope for mankind, right? Every act of their hands is wicked, is evil. Even in their hearts, all there is evil all the time. And listen, when we think about the Lord judging the world at this time, we need to be careful that we're not under, that we don't have any false illusions that the day of Noah was a great deal worse than our day today. I don't know that we can say through Scripture that we can look at the day of Noah and think that it was that much worse than the world that we live in. In fact, in Matthew chapter 24, Jesus is referring to the day of Noah. Jesus believed that the flood and that Noah, these were real people. This was actual history. And he speaks of them. And when he's talking about judgment, another judgment to come. In Matthew chapter 24, verse 38, Jesus says this. He says, for in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day Noah boarded the ark. And so even though things were evil in the days of Noah, it doesn't mean that they still didn't eat and drink and party and celebrate and live life. It sounds like they just were not aware of how wicked they really were. My friends, I think we live in a world where we're not aware often of how evil and wicked the world is that we really live in. We live in a world that has incredible violence, sexual perversion. Life is taken with no regard. The life of the unborn is not even considered life. Women and children are oppressed around the world. Women and children who are made in the image of God. Even just go deeper, take it a step further. Think about what Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount about anger. It seems as though he even equates anger with murder, doesn't he? You've heard it said, you know, should not murder one another. But, you know, I tell you, right, anybody who's angry at his brother in his heart, who treats someone's life as that person's life is worthless. He equates lust in the heart with actual adultery. Now, we know the consequences are different, but the core of the sin is the same. And so we can step back often and be in judgment of Noah's world, but in fact, I don't know that our world is any better. Whenever we struggle with the judgment of God, it is because we do not truly understand the wickedness of our sin or the holiness of God. When we struggle with what God does here in Genesis chapter 6, 7, and 8, it's because We're naive to our own evil hearts, our own wicked ways. And we also don't understand the holiness of God. So as God looks down on mankind and sees how corrupt they are, every way of mankind's heart is corrupt. There's no hope for mankind. He decides to wipe mankind out, and we see the judgment of God. And before we walk into the act of judgment, I think we need to see God's heart in judgment. Notice again what he says in verse 6. It says, the Lord regretted that he had made man on the earth, and he was deeply grieved. He was deeply grieved. That's another one of those side roads that we could spend a lot of time on. What does it mean that when it says the Lord regretted that he had made man on earth and was deeply grieved? Well, we shouldn't think of the word regret in terms of the Lord looks down and he thinks, well, man, I've made a mistake here. And he changes his mind about what he's previously done. No, one of the places in Scripture, in other places in Scripture, we need to take this in context of the whole Bible. And in Numbers 23:39, it says, God is not a man that he might lie, or a son of man that he might change his mind. There's other places that talks about that, you know, that God has known. Everything that's going to happen before the world was even founded, God knew what was going to happen. And so when God says that he regrets, probably a better translation is he grieves, he's sorry for what's taken place. Not at his creation, but the way man has corrupted his creation. He's sorrowful over man's perversion of his creation. And there's no conflict here in God knowing what will happen, but also God grieving over what has happened. In our mind, there's a conflict there, but not in the mind and the heart of God. Even if you remember in the days of Jesus, he knows Lazarus is going to die. Remember, he's on his way to Bethany. Lazarus has died there. He's on his way, and he gets news that Lazarus is dead. And Jesus knows he's going to raise Lazarus from the dead. He knows this is going to ultimately be the outcome. He says as much to his disciples, though they don't really get it. And yet as Jesus approaches the tomb of Lazarus, he sees everyone else grieving, and what does Jesus do? He weeps. So even though Jesus knows the outcome, he knows that he's going to raise Lazarus from the dead, and the glory of God is going to be revealed in the person of Lazarus, he still grieves. God is no robot. He's not up there just callously bringing about judgment or making decisions. No, it is out of the Lord's grief that he brings judgment. Look again what he says in verses 11 through 13 as he talks about this judgment. Why is he doing it this way? It says, now the earth was corrupt in God's sight, and the earth was filled with wickedness. God saw how corrupt the earth was, for every creature had corrupted its way on the earth. And then God said to Noah, I have decided to put an end to every creature, for the earth is filled with wickedness because of them, because therefore I am going to destroy them along with the earth. If you notice there, the word corrupt is used over and over again. And then again, verse 13, where the Lord says, I'm going to destroy them. That's the same word. That root word for destroy there is the same word for corrupt. And so the picture here, as the Lord looks down, he sees that mankind is corrupt and mankind is corrupting itself. Mankind, the earth, is destroying itself. And so the Lord says, I'm going to wipe out mankind, because mankind is ultimately wiping out itself, is destroying itself. So the judgment of God is not only punishment for sin, because God is a just God, right? And a just God must punish sin in the same way that a just judge must, right, deliver a sentence that's appropriate for the crime that's committed. If you went into the courtroom and the judge just let off the defendant, right, and acted like he did nothing, and there was no sentence, there was no punishment, then you would look at that judge and say, that judge can't be just. Well, God is absolute just. Absolutely just, perfectly just, and sin must be punished. But also we see here in this act of judgment, the Lord is not only acting in a righteous way, bringing justice here in an unjust world, he's also saving the earth from itself, an earth that's destroying itself. The Lord is going to do something in bringing about this flood. His end goal here is not just destruction, but it's restoration. He's going to destroy his creation. He's going to decreate in order so that he can recreate once more. The judgment of God. Then as we see, there's the judgment of God, we also find hope that we see the salvation of God in this person, Noah. The Lord finds favor in a man named Noah. And notice how it describes Noah. He's a righteous man. He who is blameless. He walked with God. And the Lord comes to Noah and he says, go and make an ark out of gopher wood. And he gives them the dimensions of the ark. If you want to see a picture of this, many of you have gone to the Creation Museum. I've not gone yet, but they have basically a replica of the ark that you can go into. How many of you guys have been to that? Anybody? Yeah, many of you. So you know more about this than I do. But Noah builds this ark. And the Lord instructs him to bring his family onto the ark. Then he instructs him to bring two of all living creatures onto the ark. And later on in chapter 7, we'll see that he also instructs him to bring seven pairs of clean animals onto the ark. Then he tells Noah to gather food and take the food and put it on the ark. And in verse 22, there at the end of chapter 6, it says that Noah did everything that the Lord commanded him to do. And just think about this for a minute. This is one of those things we kind of breezed over. This was no easy assignment to bring two of every living creature onto the ark. I mean, there had to be a temptation. I mean, if I was Noah, spiders aren't getting on, right? Snakes, I don't think so. Personally, I would have left off squirrels. Not a big fan of squirrels. But we know the Lord is involved here, right, in bringing these animals. And then it was also no easy assignment. Just because of Noah, more than likely it took him 50, 75 years. We don't know exactly how long, no more than 100. But it would have taken him decades to build this ark. And at this point in time, we don't even see rain in the Bible yet. And so he's talking about this torrential downpour, this flood coming. Right? And he kind of looks around and he basically lives in a desert. And so people have to think he's insane. And he's preaching judgment. In the New Testament, we see that right, the Spirit of Christ is preaching judgment to those who are living in time through Noah. And so Noah's preaching judgment to those around him. At the same time, he's building an ark. And nobody's ever even seen a boat before. Nobody knows what an ark is. Noah doesn't even know what an ark is. He's just following the Lord's instructions. He's being obedient, and that's what we see, this theme. Noah does everything the Lord commands, and we see that again a couple of times in chapter 7, verse 5, and verse 16. That even though this would have been extreme, right? There's no basis in Noah's mind or anybody else's mind for doing what he's doing, building an ark in the middle of the desert of this size, of this magnitude. And yet Noah is obedient. Book of Hebrews, we've been referring to that over the past couple of weeks, gives us some insight on how Noah was able to do this, right? This is in a crazy assignment that the Lord has given him. And yet, in Hebrews chapter 11, the writer of Hebrews explains Noah's outlook on what's taking place here. He says, by faith, Noah, after he was warned about what was not yet seen and motivated by godly fear, built an ark to deliver his family. And by faith, he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. So how did Noah build this ark when no one even knew what a flood was? No one knew what an ark was, a boat, preaching judgment when people were living however they wanted to live. They didn't believe God had any right to tell them what to do. Noah obeyed God in these drastic circumstances by faith. And Noah's faith, listen, let's be careful. Let's not give the ark too much of the glory here. No, Noah's faith was not in the ark. He didn't know what an ark was. His faith was in the Lord. His faith was in the word of the Lord. The Lord tells him how to build the ark. The Lord tells him who to put on the ark. The Lord tells him when to enter the ark. And ultimately here in chapter 7, we see the Lord is ultimately the one who shuts them in the ark. And so the salvation here that we see happening in Noah is not about the ark, it's about the Lord of the ark. So it starts raining 40 days and 40 nights. All the high mountains under the sky are covered with water. And the water then surges on the earth for 150 days. And every living thing was wiped off the face of the earth. Only Noah and those in the ark were saved. And then after a year of being on the ark, the Lord speaks to Noah, and that's when we pick up in Genesis chapter 8. Just turn the page. They'd been on the ark, people say, around 365 days, about a year. Once again, I mean, think, the world is now completely different. Everything that Noah once knew has now been destroyed. This is not Noah getting off the ark and walking into the Garden of Eden. No, Noah still lives outside the garden. He walks out to a world, into an earth that has been decimated and destroyed. In verse 15 in Genesis chapter 8, it says, Then God spoke to Noah, "Come out of the ark, you, your wife, your sons, and your sons' wives with you. Bring out all the living creatures that are with you, the birds, the livestock, those that crawl on the earth, and they will spread over the earth and be fruitful and multiply on the earth." So Noah, along with his sons, his wife, and his sons' wives, they came out, and all the animals and all the creatures that crawl and all the flying creatures, everything that moves on the earth, came out of the ark by their families. And then Noah built an altar to the Lord, and he took some of every kind of clean animal and every kind of clean bird and offered a burnt offerings on the altar. And when the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma, he said to himself, "I will never again curse the ground because of human beings, even though the inclination of the human heart is evil from youth onward, and I will never again strike down every living thing as I have done." Now he's speaking of through a flood there. In verse 22, he says, "As long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, and day and night will not cease." So here in chapter 8, as they come off the ark, we see the restoration of the Lord. And notice what the Lord speaks to him. It resembles something, doesn't it? The words that the Lord speaks to Noah here in Genesis chapter 8 are the same words we see there in the garden. As the Lord speaks to Adam and Eve, now he tells Noah and his family to go out and to multiply, to fill the earth, be fruitful. Noah does what, as he gets off the ark, he does what anybody would do if they've gone through such an incredible, horrific experience. He unboards the ark and he builds an altar and he begins to worship. And there, as he's worshiping, the Lord comes to him, once again gives him, he repurposes Noah now to spread his image across, right, to spread his image across the earth. But it will be done differently now because life is, once again, life is no longer as it once was. And so as they live outside the garden, he gives them more than just green grass or the green plants for nourishment. He gives them now the creatures too. And then he establishes in Genesis chapter 9, he establishes an ongoing judgment for those who would take life. As the Lord looks down and he sees the wickedness in man's heart, he knows that man will continue to take the life of man. And so he says, now if you take the life of man, it will cost you your life. And then he establishes a covenant with not only Noah here, but really with all mankind. This common grace covenant. It's for all mankind that he will no longer flood the earth. He would no longer destroy the entire earth by flood again. And he gives them the rainbow, and perhaps the rainbow was already there. We don't know, but he says this rainbow is to be a reminder for you that you don't need to be afraid of this kind of judgment again, because I will never flood the world once again in this way again to destroy mankind. But as we see the rainbow, as we are reminded of this story, it should cause us to be sober-minded. Yes, we can take comfort in the fact and imagine, right? When it began to rain the very next time, you can imagine the fear that would have sunk in Noah's heart and those that were living. And so once again, the Lord gives them this sign so they can be comforted and remember the promises of God and the covenant that he made with them. But the story, once again, should lead us to be sober-minded. Because we don't get past even the end of chapter 9 before we see the sinfulness of man again. Even after Noah, right, all that he's gone through, this, after he's seen the salvation of God with his own eyes and experience in his own life, he doesn't get past chapter 9 before he's stumbling over his own sin again. So there's a word for us, an ongoing word for all of us. And it's this, is that first the judgment, there is a judgment coming. Even though the Lord will not judge the earth with the flood again, there is a judgment that's coming one day again. This is Jesus' warning to the people of his day as he's causing them to think back. Remember the flood of Noah. Remember what happened there. People weren't ready for the judgment. And Jesus says this in Matthew 24:39. They didn't know until the flood came and swept them all away. This is the way the coming of the Son of Man will be. And so Jesus is using this story as a warning of a coming judgment that you and me, we should be ready for this coming judgment. It will not be with a flood. It will be with fire. And so don't mistake God's kindness, his patience with us, as his absence. God is not passive. No, God is waiting for those who ready themselves, right, to put their faith in Jesus. And ultimately, we see the calamities throughout the Bible, don't we? I mean, we see it, we've already mentioned one this morning, Sodom and Gomorrah and other places. The Bible seems to point to these calamities, the judgment that God brings upon his people, even in the exile, the Old Testament. These are reminders that there is a judgment coming, that God must judge sin, and because we live in a world where we all sin, for all of us have fallen short of the glory of God, all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, there is a judgment coming. And so each one of the calamities that we see in Scripture is a reminder of this reality. And although the Lord will never drown the earth again, he will deal with sin again. So there is a judgment coming. But number two, God has made known a way of salvation. God has made known a way of salvation, even though he will judge sin again. Just like Noah, or God provided a way for Noah to be saved through the ark, God now, we know the ultimate way that God has provided a way, and it's not through a man like Noah who stumbles over his own sin. No, it's through a man named Jesus who never sinned, a man who is truly righteous. It's not by boarding an ark one day that we will save. No, but it's by placing our faith in what Jesus has done on the cross. The death and the resurrection are the hope that we have in the coming of the next judgment. And then finally, we can learn through Noah, there is a hope for all who respond in faith. Friends, there is a judgment coming, but God has made a way for us to be saved. The only ones who will be saved are those who put their hope in Jesus, who respond to Jesus by faith. Just as Noah responded to the Lord's word by faith, so we must now respond to the word, his word incarnate, by faith, and place our faith in Jesus. And my friends, let this be a warning to us all, right? There is a judgment coming. And because we have all sinned, we will all stand guilty before God. in this judgment. And the only ones who are going to be saved through this ultimate judgment are those who by faith place their faith in Jesus Christ. His death, his resurrection. And for those of us who place our faith in Jesus and are found in Christ, just like the Lord shut them into that ark, oh, my friends, he shuts us into Jesus Christ. And we cannot be taken out of his hand. That's our hope this morning. That's your hope. I think one of the most simplest ways that we see it in scriptures in Romans chapter 10, verse 9. And Paul writes these words. He says, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. I want to ask you something this morning. Listen, if you're here, maybe you don't typically come to church, or maybe you just are a skeptic, and listen, I get it. But would you hear the words of Scripture this morning? There is a judgment coming. What is your hope in light of your sin? Our only hope is in Jesus Christ. And my friends, if you're here this morning, you feel the weight of your sin, there's hope for you. But it's not by putting your faith in yourself. It's by putting your faith in what God has done through his son, Jesus. Confessing this morning that Jesus is Lord, that you're not Lord, that Jesus is Lord. And believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, which means you also believe that he died upon the cross for your sin. But then he rose from that grave. You place your faith in Jesus. Let's pray together.